elite sectors understood the danger of freedom and had to constrain it. And that's the kind of system we're moving into.
Check one, two, check, check, check. You got me.
Go ahead, Ro. How you rolling, Ro?
Test one, two, test one, two.
That, you know, you can splice it here and you can splice it there.
Check, check, one, two.
Okay, now it's going to be done and done, done. Da 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 da.
Kids, don't try this at home.
There are tendencies that are driving the whole society into a kind of a sociopathic direction.
True culture is emergent.
The corporate influence designed to pacify.
Culture is not just art on a wall or music in your speakers. It's about how we value things. It's about how we approach our decisions.
The eventual consequence of everyone with their head down doing this while the world goes by.
Today, our world is being remade, yet again, by an information revolution, changing the way we work, the way we live, the way we relate to each other. It embodies our best values by supporting the kind of market reforms that the Vice President mentioned.
The world would indeed be remade, but what would it be remade into? What if we were progressing in the wrong direction? These questions weave their way within the familiar steps where I begin to find a rhythm that bridges my past to my future. And in this moment, a form of meditation takes over, creating a unique sense of independence and polyrhythmic logic. I found myself compelled. I found myself driven towards something highly unconventional, at the same time realizing that I was no one. A has-been that never really was. A failure by many definitions. Who was I to make any broad-reaching, impactful statements? Fitting pieces together that make no sense on their own. Assembling rhythm where there was none before. Improvisationally syncopating ideas based on established rudimentary structure. These things represent more than just a percussive metaphor. There is a narrative beneath the rhythm that is not easy to recognize. It would be my friends, their friends, and the friends we share between us that would give me the ability to transmit a message from the front lines of the war on our economy and culture itself. And as our present becomes our future's past, this is the time. This is the moment. Silence now has a unique, serene, beautiful quality in this noisy, individual, interrupting, brave new world. It is the silence that I am blessed with, echoes and reverberations of the past, present, and future. It's funny. I always assumed, even from childhood, that I would try to change the world around me somehow. I also naively assumed that it would be from behind the drum kit and sung into a microphone. This was not meant to be. Not for me, anyway. It would be through the refraction of the lens that my vision would finally come into focus. It was now time to step out from behind the kit and walk over to the other side of the glass. And we begin here. Detroit. Bankrupt. Abandoned. Desperately trying to reinvent in an age that has moved away from the station. The birthplace, and also the final resting place, of what was the middle class. A fallen economic and cultural leader, Now, a late night punchline. This makes it a good setting for examination. This is what this film is, an examination. A conversation that attempts to find connections in unconventional places between the state of our shared culture and the effects that it has on our society, past, present, and future. This film looks to point out multiple disconnective factors that, when combined at today's current rate, has the potential for producing massive unintended consequences.
As time goes by, and as technology keeps spreading its ever-expanding tentacles across the world, I think that there is a part of the human experience of face-to-face conversation that's lost.
I see people at the bus stop, and everybody's like down with their headphones in, and they're looking at their iPod, fiddling around with it, just doing this. And it always seemed funny to me because it was never the way it used to be, where kids would be with Walkmans or Discman or whatever the fuck. And, you know, they're fucking listening to shit, and they're, you know, they're fucking having, they're in their own head at the bus stop. Not anymore. They're fucking listening to, they got headphones in and they got their iPods and they're sifting through their songs like this. They're not even listening to shit. There's nothing going on in there. They're just reading all the albums that they have, that they've downloaded for free. And they're like, yeah, no, I don't want to listen to that. No, I don't want to listen to that. I don't want to listen to that. I don't want to listen to that. And it's like, you can tell from a mile away exactly what the fuck they're doing. And you can always tell. They ain't listening to shit. You know, but they're just like hoarders. You know, they just love to fucking consume and collect, and they just want all this shit. And, you know, for themselves, they're just to be able to have. And it's like, you know, it's just taking up data, so it doesn't matter, you know, because it's not like physical space. It's not like, you know, the amount of albums that are compiled on a fucking digital format, like without, you know, in reality, what that would be in the 80s or like the early 90s or something, you know, like your whole house would be covered, you know, filled up with fucking records, right? And we can swear, right?
If you walk around, even at the MIT campus or just at the streets, people are either looking at some device or talking on their cell phone, but not interacting with one another. And it's extremely superficial. Last winter in Boston, there was a medical problem developed, sudden problem which nobody understood, among teenage girls. They were having all kinds of medical problems. And when it was investigated, it turned out that the basic problem was fatigue. And the reason for the fatigue is that they were going to sleep with their cell phones in their hands, so that if some so-called friend called them at 3 a.m. in the morning, they wouldn't miss it, because it's so important to know that, you know, I just had a sandwich or something, so you don't sleep all night. But this, it's a sign of social dissolution, which shows up in all kinds of ways.
The interest and the inclination to shit on 17-year-olds has always been around. But I'd say now, and maybe it's because I'm the one that's shitting on them sometimes, but now there's a little bit more at stake. Before, it was this thing they were going through. Bad clothes, bad haircuts, bad music. Now, it's bad manners. It's bad communication skills. There's things that are going to carry on for the rest of their lives if we don't start addressing it now.
Don't get me wrong. I answer emails. I write my emails. But I have always and will continue to resist the phone, the iPhone, or the BlackBerry, or whatever the fuck it is this week. Because, honestly, I see, okay, put it this way, I'll go into a restaurant and boom, through the door comes three beautiful girls and a couple guys, youngsters, sit down, and they're all, instead of engaging in conversation, every damn one of them has this little machine in their hand, and they're dotting and checking and checking and dotting. And I'm sitting there just observing. They're not saying a damn thing to each other. And then I realize that they're texting each other as they're sitting next to each other. And then I have friends that Facebook each other while they're in the same building and they're in the same establishment. And I don't know, it's baffling to me.
Powering up our collective unconscious, these devices enable a false sense of connectivity and accessibility. We now swipe, then click, we drag and drop what we hold dear, taking photos of moments we are no longer a part of, capturing moments we will never get back.
For this generation's coming up, because I teach learning through the arts in the schools, and speaking with kids and figuring out what's valuable to them, I'm not sure if they really are able to connect the dots to be critical thinkers and really look critically and be able to hopefully generate some value for themselves, you know.
I can't blame it on the phone, on the iPad, on the Xbox, on the PlayStation. I can't blame it on any of that stuff. I can only blame it on myself, on the people around me.
And so what we need to really focus on as we transition in this period, so generations like mine who are part of this bridging the gap, is we have to appreciate the efficiency of this technology, but understand the beautiful history that led us to this technology.
When this becomes the introduction of one human to another is over a machine, and again, how do you read? You can't look into eyes. You can't see if there's any life, sincerity, gentleness, kindness.
There's people, and there's everything else. Technology, places. They don't have meaning unless we impose meaning upon them.
I guess I worry about kids. I don't have any. I imagine emotionally they're the same as they always were, and they're adapting to whatever it is being given to them. And I've thought about it before that, you know, that when you get to a point where theoretically, a teenager could say, oh, Hitler was the guy with the mustache, right? That, you know, you have a problem.
All these kids are on the internet and they're communicating through this media, and they're not reaching out to people. And if you don't stop and think about what you're writing, you're losing compassion. You need to have compassion for your fellow man. Because without that, we're just all little automatons, just all working around each other, and no one is connecting.
You had a culture of people that all understand, we got to keep these kids safe. We've got to do this. We've got to do this as a society. You know, we've got to teach these kids that there's more than just them. And that's gone.
What message, you know, didn't we give our young people to realize, you got to fight, dude. You got to fight for her right. You got to fight for his right. You got to fight for the right of these cats that are sitting at my feet.
Some of the most insidious aspects are the recognition, maybe 20, 25 years ago, that by the advertising industry, that there's a class of creatures who they're not reaching because they don't have money, children. So how are we going to reach them? Well, obvious way is design propaganda which will get them to nag their parents. But by now there's a field of academic psychology, literally, studying different forms of nagging for children. This is for the propaganda industries.
As long as they're sitting there surrounded by this horseshit culture, they aren't going to do anything.
We're just learning how to be consumers and not creators.
And we're living in the trickle-down from where this all starts. If it's that bad at the top, believe me, it's going to be sour at the bottom.
Unless you have a well-worked-out framework of understanding, which is not rigid. It should be open to challenge, like you ask questions about it, but at least some way of approaching the huge mass of information, you're just lost. It's part of the consumerist culture. You go back to the late 19th century. At that point, within the mass industrial system was developing, and it began to be understood that it would be efficient in a certain sense to turn people into robots, like most developments. It was designed within the government system and armories and so on, where you can control people. But it became a technique of controlling work to make it maximally efficient. There was a recognition that we can move from what was called on-job control to off-job control. Like, what about people in their regular lives? Have to find a way to control them too, to turn them into robots. And they have to be turned into consumerist, obedient robots. The ideal for the corporate system would be having a population which have no associations among one another. The elementary unit of social structure is you and your computer, you know, maybe with very superficial relations among people, like friends on Facebook, so you can have the illusion that you have friends, because if you walk across the street and you put it in your Facebook page, you'll get 200 friends saying, gee, great, hope you made it, or something. But the main part of your life must be to amass commodities. And that was quite explicit. In the huge propaganda industries, public relations industries, they used to be called propaganda, and people don't like the term anymore, but it's basically propaganda, are designed to develop off-job control to ensure that human beings don't exercise their free and independent and creative capacities, don't challenge, don't question, but simply try to be directed to the superficial things in life, like consumption, fashionable consumption. And it developed in the freest countries in the world, in England and the United States, and for good reason. Enough freedom had been won, so that it was hard to control people by force. So you therefore had to turn to the next obvious way, control attitudes and beliefs. And out of that comes this immense propaganda industry, which is originally commercial advertising, but extends to running the elections, just about every facet of life. You can't get away from it for a minute.
The Flintstones has been brought to you by Winston, America's best-selling, best-tasting filter cigarette.
Winston tastes good like a cigarette should.
For over 75 years, we have been, in many ways, devolving. What are we becoming? We consume. You are a consumer. I am a consumer. It's what we do. The American dream I was raised to believe in has long since been trampled over and exchanged for the simple need to consume. We consume everything. Products, ideas, clothing, music, film, and the perceived value for these goods or art or sounds or images diminishes as we consume more and more.
Big sales and a stampede. Shoppers pushed and shoved their way through Black Friday today, one of the busiest shopping days of the year, of course. The mad dash into a Walmart store knocked shoppers to the ground near Grand Rapids, Michigan at 5 in the morning. Despite several people falling to the ground, shoppers charged ahead, fixated on doorbuster deals. A 13-year-old girl helping a pregnant woman get up had to be taken away by ambulance.
When written in Chinese, the word crisis is comprised of two characters. One represents danger. The other represents opportunity. Maybe this is what inspired a man named Charles Sorensen, vice president of Ford Motor Company and Henry Ford's right-hand man, In 1941, with the outbreak of World War II, Charles Sorensen consulted with Henry Ford concerning the assembly of the B-24 and B-17 bombers. He estimated that it would take 100,000 workers and a $200 million plant to meet his goal of delivering one finished airplane every hour. The U.S. military did not demand one plane per hour. They did not even demand a full plane. They only required the wings and some of the chassis. They thought the assembly might take place in New Jersey, or maybe even San Diego. Sorensen countered this with an ultimatum. This new Willow Run plant would make one full airplane, or they would receive nothing. One finished airplane every hour meant many things. Many new and strange things to the manufacturing culture. Out of this irrational desire came the need for overproduction and overfacilitation that would immediately be followed by decentralization. These same philosophies and patterns would bleed into the civilian population, shaping the foundations of the modern age of consumerism. Born with the idea of this Willow Run plant and other plants just like it, this shaped the place of my birth, Detroit, Michigan, and would also have a great impact on what would eventually become my hometown of Windsor, Ontario. Both cities gained a lot of their identity and historical relevance based on people moving here to build the war machine to stop Hitler and the Japanese. My hometown of Windsor, Ontario, Canada, has remained somewhat anonymous, although its cultural and economic impact worldwide can be felt for many generations. With Windsor's key geographical position and its alliance with Detroit, and its general population of innovators and entrepreneurs, this relatively small, unknown Canadian city has left an indelible footprint on world history. For the town that easily could have been known as South Detroit, its lack of identity has been a key problem throughout the years. Windsor would also be known as many other nicknames, but none of them would ever really come to represent what this city's true identity is.
When you go to war and you send over 5 million Americans and 1 million Canadians, what do we have? 9.5 million people in Canada and 1 million went over there? No. The man of the house was 14 and all the women working at the Ford Motor Company were all Rosie the Riveter. There were 125 pound women doing the job of 200 pound men building tanks and stuff. So all that Southern stuff came up. They brought great barbecue, right? And they brought the blues and jazz, and they brought their culture.
After World War II, Detroit and Windsor became sort of the land of opportunity for people that may not have had it where they were. So you had this conversions, this mass migrant worker movement, if you will, where everybody could have a job at the factories. And it gave opportunity to people that had maybe a language barrier or even a race barrier, where to have that kind of opportunity in the South in 1945 may have been a very different thing. You work hard, you play hard, and everybody, every minority group, everybody had expendable money like no one had ever had in North America before. The birth of the middle class.
Well, the city of Detroit is an idea. It is the badass city. It's the burned out city. It's a city of great energy and great independence.
Once, you know, what would be my grandparents' generation, these men of World War II, these vets, once their kids had that amount of opportunity to them, they started to seek their own identities. And the music and art that came out of that was world definitive. They were the sound of young America. They weren't the sound of young black America or young white America. It was for everybody. It's interesting that, you know, one of the stations that would go on to really break Motown in across America and then, you know, across Canada and then onto the world was a Windsor station that could choose to support basically whatever and whoever they wanted.
You know, they were the CNN, you know, they'd give you the music, man, that you needed to survive, you know.
KOW on AM was really the big thing. I mean, whenever we were in the car or even at home, I mean, it was common to have the radio on the house, you know. Now we don't have radios playing as much.
And if you call right now, we'll give you a full box of baby chickens. That's right. You can order a full box of baby chickens right here from John R. And they are good eating. Trust me, folks, I wouldn't lead you wrong. I'm your daddy-o, the radio, your platter-pushing papa, the boss man.
So if you weren't listening to AM WJR, listening to Tiger Baseball...
I love listening to those games. I couldn't figure out how Ernie Harwell knew where every kid was from and caught a foul ball.
There was like a whole era there where radio was as important as the bands.
But CKLW in particular was just a wonderful station. It was, you know, so powerful you could hear it all over the Midwest.
And it was a Windsor radio station. What a beautiful thing.
Canadian radio was just, I don't know, just... It's always been great.
Well, growing up, I mean, CKLW was in Windsor, and that's where we grew up listening to all that music. It's really an extension of Detroit. There's just a river in between it.
I would turn on CK, the Big Eight, and I would hear the Rolling Stones, the Rationals, the Beatles, Bob Seger.
Smokey Robinson, the Temptations, the Four Tops, Martha Reeves, the Supremes, this... incredible explosion of music happened.
It was the greatest stuff in the world, and I didn't know that, like, the Detroit bands were local.
Ted Nugent and Alice Cooper and the Frost and, you know, Frigid Pink and Grand Funk Railroad coming out and sort of defining an era of rock and roll that was hard-edged.
Before it got real regulated, Detroit radio reached, you know, I mean, it reached coast to coast, but in Detroit, you know, like Windsor, CKLW was a beacon.
Back in those early days, CKLW was the big wave. That was the radio station. If you got solid play on CKLW, there was a real good chance you're going to have a hit record. That station was just monstrous. That was the station.
It was more wide open than the bean counters, and MBAs hadn't taken it over yet. It was pretty wide open. You could hear a lot of different types of music. It wasn't all segmented and boxed in all these genres like it is now.
The only thing that mattered was it a great song? And, you know, that I cherish that education, because it's not like that now.
CKLW started to become a voice or an outlet for the voice of that generation.
You sit there at your kitchen table eating your Cheerios, and then that's what you basically were influenced by. Detroit Radio, CKLW.
And serving up that cereal with a little bit of milk and sugar was an eventual music and radio legend, Rosalie Tremblay, arguably the most influential program director of all time.
And later having the honor to meet Rosalie Tremblay and become her friend and really get to talk to her about that time, you know, and, I was just, you know, blown away by, you know, her ears were incredible. She really didn't listen to all the so-called experts and the big record guys that would come in and try to push what the record company wanted them to push. Rosalie just went after the songs. And, you know, she knew she had this audience not only in Windsor, but it was Detroit. And, you know, she was so conscientious of that audience that she had. And I think that, you know, everything she wanted to do was to please that audience in both Windsor and Detroit. And so, you know, she played a lot of things that other people wouldn't play. And now, you know, we hear now, and I hear it from other people in the business, how she influenced most of the country. They would just, what is CKLW playing?
CKLW and Rosalie Tremblay were not the only international influence. By 1966, Detroit was booming. Our manufacturing plants and assembly lines drove the post-World War II North American economy. Our music, our radio, was defining genres. Our general way of life was becoming the model of what the American dream was. And what we didn't know at the time is, as fast as it came, it would all disappear.
My father worked at Chrysler. He was working at Chrysler. When he came back from the war, he worked at Chrysler. As far as what was going on in Detroit with the riots, I don't believe my parents were scared
of African Americans, so to speak. They were afraid that they were going to be killed because they were close to what was going on. I'm not 100% on how it was quelled. Obviously, the military did that. But could it have spread? Could it have spread throughout Michigan? Could it have spread throughout the country? It could have. Now, they were afraid for their lives. I mean, you can get, there's crossfire. I mean, there's anything can happen in civil unrest that's so violent. They had no problem with African Americans or Hispanics or Middle Easterns or anything like that. They were afraid for their life, right? And it was violent. So my dad put us in a car, and he tells a story. He could hear bullets, guns going off. He could see fires everywhere. And this was at night. He's heading towards the bridge. We're going to Canada. We're just going to Canada. And it was either the National Guard or a police officer pulled us over, and they're like, "What are you, sir? What are you doing in the streets? What are you doing in the streets right now?" He says, "I'm going to Canada." And my mother and I were stuffed in the front seat on the floor because there's gunfire going off, right? It doesn't matter if it was whites with guns or African Americans with the guns or the police. Didn't matter. There was guns going off. And the city was on fire.
You are about to witness the very exciting story of a city and its people. It will be an adventure that will open new sights in familiar surroundings. It is a story of a city seeking new horizons in a resolute contest with great challenges. That city is Detroit.
Yeah, check it, 1, 2. There's nobody in Detroit.
States Olympic Committee has chosen Detroit, Michigan as its nominee for the 1968 Olympic Games.
Nobody in Detroit, yeah.
Yes, Detroit is enjoying its finest hour. There is a renaissance, a rebirth in the city. There's a newness in Detroit.
This so-called newness would include generational cycles of failure and denial that would make an already crumbling icon quickly become the most misunderstood city in American history, on a path to a dark, dark place.
In my lifetime, it's been a really depressed area. I mean, I wasn't born for the heyday of, you know, the industrial era, Detroit's ascension to industrial might and wealth and all those cultural developments, even Motown, music like that. That's before my time. And my affiliation with it was like empire in decline, you know. It was a really depressing area. I got robbed at gunpoint in a White Castle by the guy at the White Castle. You know, like I drove up to the drive-thru to get burgers and got robbed by the guy working at the White Castle. You got a job and you're robbing me.
The strength of these two border cities used to be its connectivity. It was our potential. Collaborations blossomed, and in a state of decline, it didn't matter. Most of my life, it was only a river between us.
When I was younger, people saw the border either as a doorway. They saw the tunnel, they saw the bridge, or they saw a wall. And I never saw a wall. I used to go over sometimes two or three times a day, you know, with my, sometimes not even with ID, going back and forth, seeing friends, you know, coming back, going back at 2 a.m. again for a concert, coming back, going over for breakfast. And then as my career started, as I started DJing, as we started running our record label that was based here, we had an office in Detroit, we would go back and forth.
International goodwill is perhaps experienced most frequently at the border between the United States and Canada. Thousands go back and forth daily between Detroit and Windsor, Ontario.
This is, it's a border city. Everybody, most main successful businesses here operate somehow on both sides. That was not only our financial success, but that also based upon my creative success.
Being born in Detroit and growing up in Windsor, an American living in Canada, in a very unique time, in a very unique place. Logically, one would gain a very unique perspective. The question may be, does the examination of our economic failures and cultural successes benefit anyone?
That's an interesting question, because first, you have to talk about the stigma of having to leave one small town, right? Especially this town called Windsor, who for the most part is not taken very seriously by the United States. And as I've witnessed, as being lucky enough to have traveled my own country, Canada, it's not recognized by our own country. We're stuck right in this place in the middle somewhere, and it's hugely frustrating. And it develops an enormous inferiority complex. No way around it.
There's the sense that people just don't think good things artistically can come from Windsor. Hear it all the time. Wow, that band's really good. They could be on the radio. It's like, there's just this mentality that like factory worker, blue collar equals no room for artistic growth or artistic success.
You know, I'm playing in Big Sugar for a period of, at this point, it might be a year, year and a half in, and I'm doing a lot of traveling because everybody else lives in Toronto, so I got a little bit more to do, right, to get to rehearsals, which we didn't actually have a lot of, but, you know, that was just, you know, I'm going, you know, do you think, I would say to him, you know, one day I said, maybe I should move up here. Like, I don't know how I'm going to do that. Joanne's got a great job, and I love Windsor. It's where I'm from, and we got a home there, but you know, maybe I should do that, take a little wear and tear off the travel part of it all. And he said, no, don't do that. Because he said, what you bring is a stink that you got from living in Windsor and Detroit.
The blessing in disguise there, you know, where now you look back at it and go, wow, I wouldn't have rather grown up anywhere.
The early part of the Detroit rock revolution in the 60s was also experienced in Windsor.
You hear it in songs, and you know, Journey made it famous when they, you know, South Detroit is Windsor. But raised in
South Detroit. You know, aside from the music, you know, all the art and the, you know, the bonding of this community, we all do a lot together and help each other out, you know, instead of working against each other and trying to get ahead and using other people as stepping stones, we use each other as allies.
So we get to Sweden and Norway and we're doing festivals, and it was weird because everybody over there is going, where's the guy from Detroit? And they're like, oh my God, dude, you're from Detroit? I go, yeah. And it was like coming from, you know, Valhalla, like to them, Mecca, you know, there's like, wow, what a cool music city, you know. And I go, yeah, but, you know, we're all, you know, we're musicians from the States, and, you know, all these guys are from Mississippi, but they were like, yeah, but Detroit is the key.
Well, playing in LA and New York, the perception and the response from the audiences there has been awesome. When I tell them that we're from Detroit, they scream and go crazy.
It's like the Chinese invented fireworks. You know, everybody wants to get a pack of, you know, bottle rockets. Detroit invented hardcore rock and roll, and everybody wants to hear some of that.
We had no venues at all in London and Toronto that were anything like Detroit.
Definitely Detroit's contributions
to the culture, just to Western musical culture, are massive. Massive.
There's so much good stuff coming out of here and will continue to come out of here that has a Detroit attitude that people crave. It just doesn't seem to come from other cities like it comes from here. There's like a Detroit grit.
So there's an energy, for some reason, in that city that feeds on music and feeds the music being made. It's pretty incredible because you don't see it anywhere else. People in Detroit take their music seriously.
When you see Detroit on CNN or whatever, you know, all they're going to show is the abandoned train station. They're going to show all this terrible, disgusting, burned down buildings. They're not going to show all the kids down here running around, making all this awesome art, playing these awesome shows.
It blows my mind how that could happen when we have this major metropolis of Detroit beside us, and it's such a legendary city, and it's a breathtaking city, and it actually pisses me off because having the opportunity to work over there now and see what that city is all about and how it thrives, and the bad rap that they get from people saying, you know, murder capital, and you know, I'll tell people like we're playing in Detroit, or they're like, aren't you scared to play over there? Can you get mugged or something? And you know, I'm fortunate enough where I've never been mugged, but not once can I say we've ever had a bad problem over there. And I think what's hindered a lot of people from coming to this area is the bad rap that we get because of the media and because of people saying just stuff that's just not true, and that kind of stuff carries on, so young kids don't want to stay here.
Detroit is an idea, but it's also a duality. It operates on this musical energy, and then it has the other side of Detroit, which is a little more negative. And then maybe right in between is this part of Detroit that now people are taking pride in again, and it's rebuilding itself from the center of the city.
Detroit definitely has its own vibe culturally. It's certainly different from Toronto, and you know, it's different from the rest of Canada. I think Windsor's different from the rest of Canada just as a result of being so close.
It's the Canadian counterpart to what Detroit is. Maybe not with as much of the abandoned buildings, but that's probably just because they tear them down and build something else where the abandoned building was. You know, when I tell people where I'm from, I usually say Detroit and then explain south of Detroit in Canada, in Windsor.
Being in Windsor, it's kind of like the gateway to everywhere.
There's a certain real thread here in Windsor, I think a real sort of like real strong stamina that we have, and we have a real thick skin.
And that leaves us kind of to, you know, create our own way and kind of find our own place and make something work.
That's what happens around here. People write, you know, people self-finance their art project. They don't wait around for some grant. They just do it.
And it's the river and the land that sustain us, not the automotive industry. We have to get away from that thinking. We have to reinvent what our concept of life is in Windsor. We have to think about what we are going to be. Right now, we're stuck in neutral. Actually, we might be even going in reverse.
I think this whole area has this "don't feel sorry for us" kind of attitude, and I think that's the right thing to do.
It's like that comparison of the seed of a lotus that's in the muck, that sits there forever, and then decides to start pushing its way up through the muck, slowly pushing, and breaks free of the water, untouched, right? Like, totally perfect.
As bad as it gets around here, people will always seek out some relief from it, you know, and creative people especially will dig a little deeper, and, you know, not just sing out their suffering, but we can also make joyous music in the midst of all that. You know, it can be done. So that gives a person hope, I think, even in the worst of times.
And it's the worst of times that keep finding their way back. And as we struggle to reinvent within it all, it becomes more and more obvious that it wouldn't be as simple as just retapping old resources. There would be new roadblocks, new setbacks, new realities.
Specifically, I think it was maybe like 3 or 4 weeks after September 11th, and we showed up with our guitar cases in the back, and the guys at this time at the border were all in their military, you know, f-
full outfits and everything, and guns and all this stuff pulled up. And the best thing I remember was the day that we went over. This is like maybe 2-3 months after September 11th. We pulled up to the border, and we hear alarms going like beep, 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 just like alert, alert, alert. So we're like, what the hell? The guy says, turn the car off. 6 or 7 officers run over and have their guns ready to go on us because everybody's all jumpy. Well, the guy who I was with at a gym, he had x-rays done. So, you know, of course they were reading radiation, so they were ready to blast us because of it.
I mean, even though it's only a river, there's like a wall up there, and it's totally different.
Like, from one day to the next, there was 100-foot high, 10-foot thick wall, and we couldn't do business. We couldn't, you know, go and get inspired. You know, yeah, you could go over, but passports, this and that. I have a Canadian passport, a British passport at that point. I have Canadian now, but like, it was another layer of complexities.
People wouldn't cross the border. You know, people were frightened.
The border pretty much became less of a friendly border to an armed port. And it's still like that.
If you can believe this, I was working for a lady downtown, and I was her general manager / disc jockey. The best year that she had in her building at her bar was August 2002. There was a resurgence. Everybody was, it was almost like it was like a fuck you, we're not gonna take this. You know, it was a great attitude. But then it started getting compiled with things that were government led. First one that happened was like they started putting these codes on the border of like where the terrorist level was going to be with these different color codes, right? Just to instill just a little bit of fear in these people. And the Americans were slowly like, oh, I'm not gonna go, you know, like, oh, there's an orange fucking alert, you know. What the hell does that mean? You know, like orange alert. So then the next thing that would happen is that the American dollar started to crash, and then the Canadian dollar started to pair out. So then there was this parity level. So then that was another thing that was added on top of that. So then just a little bit more people wouldn't come, you know, because they didn't stretch that dollar a little bit more. So now you have orange alerts, you have the dollar, now you have smoking. And then literally the nail in the coffin was when the United States said, in order to come back into our country or to visit our country, you need a passport.
The general loss of the simple ability to live freely, as we have come so accustomed to, and when you also combine living an international cross-border experience, it becomes very obvious just how many freedoms we have lost. And at the same time, shifting 180 degrees from a producing nation to a consuming nation, add in the current cultural paradigms in which value is being exchanged for immediacy. We have a set of circumstances that enable patterns of failure. The demise of these two once great cities may foreshadow something entirely different, and our vision narrows, yet becomes quite clear that the combination of traditionally disconnected factors can produce unintended consequences. And as we as a society progress, with little regard for consequence, this last factor that we will introduce may be the most unseen, yet most important factor against the ability to own our own voice ever again.
When you have a monopoly of the source by which you receive your information, you got all the deck stacked against you, especially if you watch and believe.
We don't have limited choice, you know, despite, you know, all of this foreboding, you know, corporate monopoly, you know, the internet and all this stuff. We have choice. I think the biggest problem is that it's incredibly anxiety-inducing and extremely overwhelming to deal in a culture that is just sort of 24 hours a day vibrating with bullshit. But usually, you know, you can turn off whatever's vibrating. I can't stress that enough.
Did you see a particular turning point where that pop culture got away from its original intentions?
Like, yeah,
you
said, Woodstock.
That was the moment?
Well, that's when it was perceived by the entertainment industry as a major market. And everything shifted from there. It changed from resisting our cultural movement into trying to figure out how to buy it off. We'll be right back.
1973, the rule was created because to prevent a monopoly. Everybody knows that power corrupts, and absolute power corrupts absolutely. So to avoid that kind of monopoly, the 777, the 777 rule, FCC, the Federal Communications Commission, made it so that you could only own 7 AM, 7 FM, and 7 television stations, which prevented the monopoly. I used to go over to Spiro's house in Cleveland, you know, and here's Herman Spiro that owns the station, and he's out in the backyard, and we're playing football with his kids, and he's barbecuing. I mean, it was family. There was a dad right there in charge of what his kids were seeing, and he was a granddad too. So not only did he have the interest of his children, but his grandchildren.
And it was for the people, by the people, with the people. It was the people.
In 1984, over 50 corporations owned the majority of the mainstream broadcast media. The Rule of Seven, combined with similar legislation and people in the position of power that acted as cultural vanguards, for years would effectively protect us from monopoly ownership. By 2005, only 6 corporations owned the majority of the mainstream broadcast media. When the restrictions were lifted, it didn't take long for the competition to disappear.
By removing the artificial barriers between different telecommunications sectors, this legislation will spur private investment.
In 1995, when the deregulation occurred, the moral conscience disappeared. There was no conscience, and you see the results now. The degradation from 1995 until now. What can't you see on television? What don't you see? And this is all because of that deregulation. When they deregulated, you could own as many stations as you could afford.
In 82, I played with Ted Nugent, MTV started, and I noticed things changing. You had consultants coming up, playing, living like in LA and telling Detroit what to play on their music. And what that did was all the local stuff that was going on in Detroit went out the window.
The early days of radio, you know, I hate to see that go. The old ABX days where the disc jockey would come on the air and he would play whatever he wanted to play at the moment. It's not a pre-programmed thing like it is nowadays, you know. Everything is set in stone nowadays. These guys play what, you know, they're told to play.
Can any young kid today who's 15 and 16 go to any radio station, CKLW, WJBK, ABX, any of those stations that I used to walk into as a kid and just walk in and the guy would say, "Hi, how are you? This is the new stuff that's happening. We want to hear the new stuff. We got it right off the streets. It's coming into you right now." That's the beauty of it. Now it's, we got the new stuff. It's right off the press. They spent $500,000 to make this product. They're paying us this much money to tell you that we like it. And they didn't even hear it yet to tell you if they like it. They just play it. That's not being a clear channel. That's being a foggy channel.
And today the problem is that even the news isn't truth. Back then, if you heard something on the news, it was the truth. There were a group of people who were checking facts, we're going back to the original source and making sure that this information was the truth so that you could look at the facts and form your opinion.
I think it's tough. You got so many people trying to give you the same information. Well, how do you choose? What are you listening to? Well, okay, well, that story's a little bit different than this story, and that one's more dramatic than this one and that one. You know, it's hard to find the truth in it, and I think that's tough because that's my generation, and even younger, kids younger than me, that's what they've grown up. That's the norm for them.
The difference now is that you've got these 24-hour news stations, and people are standing up there, and they don't have scripts, and they don't have people checking the facts, and they're running out of things to say, and so they're speaking their opinion. And it has become opinion news. Now, how can you form an opinion from an opinion? How can you
form an opinion without a fact.
Mainstream is manipulated, and it is owned by people without conscience. And the sickness of their dream is unfolding before us, and we wonder why we're off balance. It doesn't feel right, and, you know, something in the milk ain't cream here.
And the machine keeps going, and the machine has an agenda. And I think part of that agenda is to keep the herd mentality so intact and to keep people distracted.
It's too much like separation and everything. It's like your death metal, then there's your Cookie Monster metal, then there's your heavy metal, then there's your 80s metal, then it goes to hard rock, you know, then there's pop, and then there's R&B pop, then there's rap, you know. It's too separated. Everything's too separated.
Segmented, broken down, categorized, everything is simple. One click, one swipe. This is everywhere. It's not just one city. It's not just one country. Everywhere is becoming the same. In this production, we traveled from Windsor to Detroit, to Boston, to New York, out to Los Angeles, and back. And we got a good look at the attitudes and beliefs and the general state of our shared culture. And the state of our shared culture is a huge indicator, and it measures where we are as a society. Do we not refer to the ancient hieroglyphs, the art of that culture, to see what it produced for itself and the world around it?
Today being such an instantaneous, self-gratifying, one chance and then you're done, doesn't exactly plant the seed of dreaming bigger. We see all the time in this business, you work on a single for somebody, if that's not successful, they don't get a chance to do an album. They get pushed aside for the next possible hit.
There's no nurturing of bands, there's no anything like that. So they always, it's that, I don't want to sound like that old guy, because I'm not, because I'm all for young and upcoming and brilliance, and I'm all for rehashing. I'm all for doing, you know, if stoner rock was your thing growing up in high school, and but it's been done before, if Sabbath was your dad's favorite band, but you want to do Sabbath, but you put your little twist on it, that's what it's about. That's invention. That's doing it, and doing it for real. But pressing buttons and programming and auto-tuning and et cetera, et cetera. And we all know the pitfalls and the traps and the BS that's involved in some of it. It serves a purpose in business. It doesn't serve a purpose in the artistic community. And as a business, business is good. I mean, if you're in the business of shit, business is really good.
I mean, you get that when you look at all these, you know, X Factor and American Idol and all that. Everybody sounds the same. Nobody's individual anymore.
They don't have the exposure of any of those things where music was still pure and awesome. Now it's just like, well, we're just going to feed you this now and you're going to eat it.
We tried to deny the illusion because we like what they're feeding us.
Ditch everything that you're doing to be creative and be different and really original and take a look at what's really popular now and what's blowing up now, and try to emulate it, and try to be redundant, try to be derivative, make sure that your lyrics are really clear and relatable to, like, pretty much anyone, whether they were, like, an old man or, like, a young boy or girl. Like, don't make your music niche in any sort of way. Like, make it as easily consumable as possible, because you will never make a real kind of true fame and fortune in the way that any of these celebrity people that you've been like kind of cultured to think are celebrities, because they're not even actually celebrities. Like, you're being made to think that somebody is famous because there's like this corporate engine behind them that puts their face on every billboard. Like, they're teaching you to think that this person is who they are.
Anybody can be a star. With no talent, you can be a star. It's all about celebrity now.
There's so much distraction
with our, in our culture nowadays, with the internet, your people are on their phone. They'd rather be on their phone rather than talking to the person themselves in front of them. You know, we see people in bars and no one's having conversations. It's indicative of where we're heading.
You know, it's a double-edged sword because you could get it to more people that way with the way things are nowadays, but you know, that whole tangible thing that you held in your hands, is it's not there anymore. So you kind of lose a connection. You know, people used to read the lyrics and the, you know, look at the pictures of the band. It used to be a big part of making a record. But nowadays, you know, people, it's almost, they need something instant. They need it right now. So, you know, the experience has changed.
The beautiful thing about the internet is it does enable artists who haven't been fortunate enough to be in my position to be on that stage, whether it be in Europe or Australia or wherever, and I know fortunate and lucky and so on, but have the skills that far exceed any of ours. You know, jazz, for example, never gets radio play, but now there's a forum and a medium for which true artists will have a platform. On the flip side, there's a whole lot of shit out there that you have to rifle through to get to something good. And the problem is it's the shit that gets all the kudos and all the deals, because it's the fast food mentality and the quick fix. It's the cocaine of the industry. It's the ice, it's the crack. It's like one hit, gone, see ya.
Well, we're in a culture now where a DJ can get $100,000 for an appearance. More than the musician that recorded the song that they're playing. I think we've gone awry.
I think that everything kind of goes in cycles, and it's got to break up. It can't keep getting so specific. It can't keep targeting so specifically before people just don't care anymore.
This year, I've made a decision in 2013. I've thrown pitch correction out the window. No more fucking pitch correction in my studio. I'm fucking sick of it. None of my favorite records have any kind of artificial talent on them. You know, the bands came in and they kicked ass and they made great fucking records. That's sadly lacking these days.
You almost got to go completely backwards to go forwards and realize where everything came from.
Like, put it like this, the youth culture today, I think they're losing out on the history and the sense of real music, playing music, hands-on, and the development of it, how to adapt to it with the heart and soul, more so than just being so mechanical with it.
The democratization of technology is slowly removing value from key elements of our shared cultural identity. Music, photography, and filmmaking go hand in hand, and all of these shared cultures have become some of the first casualties to a new age. What happens to the future of these art forms as we move forward without looking back?
I think with the advancement of computers now, you know, on every creative field, you have Photoshop, you have for photographers, you have Final Cut Pro for video editors. And you have Fruity Loops, Logic, Ableton, Pro Tools for people like me.
I'm always fixing things now. You know, like, it's always post-production. I always, you know, all that anxiety and everything that you're existing in a shoot is, you know, as far as post-production is concerned, oh, I'll fix that later, I'll, you know, worry about that later. It's a very unfortunate way to approach photography, but that's the industry standard now. I mean, in a lot of ways, it's more difficult for someone like me that's professionally trained in the old school, because I worked with the restrictions. That's what I was an expert at manipulating. Now, I can sometimes achieve the best photographs from just experimentation on set.
There's so much you can do now compared to what you used to. There was a dark room before. There was limited amount of things you could use to create special photograph. So people had to think harder in that case as well. So they had to come up with different ways how to utilize that lighting to create that wow effect, that special effect.
The thing that people are forgetting is the time and the energy and the effort and all the talent stuff that actually goes into that one little photograph.
The ability to alter it in post. Now there's colorists out there that are making $500,000 a year. people that were essentially $60,000 a year technicians before, now they can take a cinematographer's work, somehow track it, recolor it, adjust the shadows, do a lot of work, all of a sudden make it a little bit sexier, make up for a lot of mistakes that are happening on set.
The technical element of photography was the number one element prior to digital, and now it's lost. It's somewhere else. It's a one-click wonder world.
The interest in this medium, in the social mediums, in photography, any kind of communication medium, while is needed and has always been necessary, it's unfortunate in that it's an indicator of the demise of what has been a great culture and a great nation. These nations, Canada, the US, North America, the Western culture in general, was built on industry, was built on physically manufacturing, about ingenuity, those kind of things. It's being maintained on the back of films and popcorn. That's usually an indicator of the declination of something.
I think those are some of the cultural conflicts that are closely connected to the malaise in the society today. And that's real. Take a look at polls. People don't trust anything. They dislike the executive. They don't like banks. They don't trust the Supreme Court. They don't like science. Nothing is trusted. And I think that's a it's kind of a natural consequence of leaving people alone, drifting in a complicated world with no rich associations and interactions and institutions that they can be part of and can control. And these are serious issues.
It's funny, everybody lists truth as something, as a virtue for themselves, but nobody ever wants to hear it.
I think people are going to just kind of gravitate towards what their own Google Plus hangout or their Facebook mutual friends agree on is something to think about. I think you've got to go beyond that and find people that you really trust and you really think about and look at the things that changed and shaped them. And I want my son to see the things that made me who I am and why I feel about the way I do.
It's got to get to the point where people are working together and building for something and trying to achieve some serious goal, which they can do.
But I just pray that the people coming up now will take it into their own hands. Like, we didn't know what we were doing in the 60s. We couldn't take it anymore. We wanted to find a different way.
If there's going to be leaders, it's going to be artists and artisans that make that happen. That's going to be the currency. That's going to be the language.
But not if they're isolated. And it's a very atomizing society for good reasons. If people aren't atomized, they will get together and go after our throats, as Emerson put it. Develop off-job control, turn them into robots, whether it's childhood, adult consumerism, diverting people to irrelevant activities, you know, having them focus their attention on sports or going to the shopping mall, but not thinking of going after our throats, asking about the institutional structures in which they live, their own loss of freedom, independence, and what they can do about it, which is a lot, because it's a lot of freedom has been won, so people have opportunities. And therefore, it is important to develop these systems of domination and control, which strikingly did develop in the freest countries. But no aspect of life can be left untouched. Everything has to be turned into a system of production of value for those who dominate and control the system, which by now is an extremely narrow sector with the financialization of the economy, the sharp concentration of wealth, and so on. Well, the effect on culture is similar. But people do resist. So there's constant development of rebellious, independent culture. It can be blues, it can be jazz, it can be rap, it can be independent documentary, all kinds of things which people just refusing to be controlled.
And you chance of secondary consequences.
It's a glorious day. Susie?
Yes.
What do you think?
I love it.
I think it's really good.
It's really, really good.
It's a glorious day. Choir.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. I'll probably have like a men's choir or something.
It'd
be really cool.
Let me write this down first. This day. It's a working man's Christmas.
That line.
It's a working man's Christmas. What a glorious day. It's a glorious day.
It's an anthem.
Dusty, what is your reason why you're there? Behind me here we have Philip Whitfield, our geese. Banging on the drums back here we've got Jon Gillies. On the bass guitar we have Josh Zaylor. To my left right here, we have the one, the only, the maestro of rock, Dave Wagner. And to my far left, your captain and mine, Marc, Farner.
I drove the tunnel in the winter.